this series of messages that the Lord has laid on my heart to preach, we'll be reading again from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Amen. Now, we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It seems like the Lord really wants somebody to know that he's coming. Not only to know it by just hearing it, amen, but believing it that the Lord is coming back. Now, we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, neither by spirit nor by word, nor by letters from us, as that day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, shewing himself that he is God. And again, he reminds them, he said, Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. And he's trying to get across to them. And evidently he has repeated himself. We don't know how many times, but he's reminding them, remember when I was yet with you, I told you these things. You ought to know these things, and we have a need to know the times that we are living in. Amen. So say amen as you be seated. And again, I want to title this message, amen, today. The stage is being set, part six, titled The Rapture, subtitled Pre, Mid, or Post Tribulation. Pre, mid, or post tribulation. I'll explain that in just a bit. Amen. But as we preached last week, if you was with us, on the subject of the rapture itself, and we took scripture and proved that it is sound doctrine that there's an event going to take place in the future that we refer to as the rapture of the church, which just simply means that the Lord is going to step out in the clouds and make a call for his bride, his church, we that which are alive and remain. And then, of course, the dead in Christ shall rise first. We proved that by scripture last week. Amen. So the Lord led us on into this message, amen, titled Pre-Mid or Post-Tribulation. Amen. Because it is very important to know when the rapture is going to take place. And I'll explain all of that later. Amen. That's why we titled it as such, because there's three different doctrines as to the rapture of the church. One is true, and two is false. Amen. One is true, and two is deceptive. Amen. It certainly is, and we'll perhaps get into that later on. Amen. But as you know, in my teachings and preachings, I preach a pre-trib rapture, which simply means that I believe the next event to take place on God's prophetic time clock is the rapture of the church. And then immediately following, there will be 7 years of great tribulation in which the Lord will execute his judgment upon this world. Now, that's my teaching. The mid-tribulation doctrine is this. There are those that teach that the great tribulation period will start, the Antichrist will be revealed, and 3.5 years into that 7 years, the rapture will take place. And then there's the post-tribulation doctrine, which teaches that the Antichrist will be revealed, then will be begin the 7 years of great tribulation, and that the rapture won't take place until the conclusion of those 7 years. That's why it's referred to as the post-tribulation. And they teach that the Lord is only coming back one more time and for all people, Jews and Gentiles. And that is not true. Absolutely. In fact, I want to show you in Scripture, and that is one of the greatest controversies in Bible prophecy, is that they don't understand that the Lord is actually coming back to this place twice. I've referred to and titled it in my teachings a two-fold coming, but he's actually going to make an appearance twice, which is yet future. And then, again, that is the controversy. How many times is the Lord coming back? And they that teach this other doctrine said, well, that's foolish. We all believe that the Lord's coming back, but he's only coming back one more time for his people. And that is just scripturally not true. Absolutely not true. Another thing that they can't understand is that the Bible teaches emphatically, amen, that there is a secret coming of the Lord. And they say, no. No, when he comes, he's coming one time, and everybody's going to see him. But I want to, the first place I want to go in Scripture actually tells it all as far as I'm concerned. But some people are just hard to convince some kinds of biblical truths. And Paul sums it all up, amen, and as I get into proving that it's going to be a pre-tribulation rapture, amen, Paul said, and we covered these scriptures last week, but for the sake of this message, we'll cover them again today. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17 and 18. Paul said, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain, now watch this, shall be, in the key words here, is shall be caught up. I don't know what kind of dictionaries a lot of people use, but up to me means just that, going up, right? And that's exactly what it is meant here. And shall be caught up together with them, where? In the clouds. Now, where are the clouds? Oh, glory to God. They are in the air. Well, even though these little children know where the clouds are, well, they're up yonder. You can look out your window and you can see them. So that's where the Lord is coming. In his first coming, he's only coming in the midst of the clouds. He will never touch one foot on this planet. Paul is telling us distinctly here. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord. There's going to be a meeting place between God and his people. And it's not on earth, it's in the clouds. How many say that? To meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And then he said, you all comfort one another with these sayings. You see, we need to encourage one another when we're going through hard times and bad times and things are not going right. Amen. It's going to all be over after a while. Amen. The Lord's going to bless us and he's going to carry us out of this world. Now, will everyone see him? Now, as far as I'm concerned, I don't have to go anywhere else in Scripture than here. It clarifies it to me. But for the sake of study and teaching, we do. And the question is, at this appearing of the Lord for his church, will everyone see him? And the answer is no. Absolutely no. You say, prove it, preacher. I'm going to. glory. I know it's a little quiet, but I want you to soak in. I want you to just be like a sponge. You don't even have to shout amen. You don't have to shout, stomp your feet, or do nothing. Just sit there and listen. Because you need to know these things. Paul said in Hebrews 9:28, now watch this. So Christ was once offered to buy the sin to many, and unto them, he's speaking to the saved, and unto them that are, that look for him, watch it now, shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. It is clear in Hebrews 9:28 that the only people that will see him at this coming are the ones that are looking for him, and the only people that are looking for him are those that are saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized in his name, prayed up, and ready to go up. I don't mean to be offensive, but they say such among us, but now you're not looking for him. I'm telling you, some God's people are looking for him. And to them that are looking for him, to them will he appear the second time without sin and the salvation, Paul says. It's clear that everybody won't see him. So I told some of you sitting here right now, if the Lord would have come right now, you'd be left behind and you would never see him. And if he comes in the middle of the night and you're in a bed, you'll wake up and something will be missing. For the thief, whoa! Somebody say the thief. For the thief would have come and gone. You say, preacher, you calling Jesus a thief? Yes. He's a true thief. Man, I've got 5 years of teaching and preaching, trying to do in 30 minutes. Jesus is a true thief. Are we not referred to Scripture as his jewels? Yes, we are. And I'm going to prove to you he's going to come at the midnight hour when the world is asleep and steal away those jewels. Yes, he is. So Christ was once offered to buy the sins of many, and unto them that look for him will appear to them the second time without sin unto salvation. So this coming, he's going to slip in and slip out just like a thief would do when he's eyeing up your house, see something there that he wants, that he don't want to borrow from you, that he don't want to buy from you, that he wants to steal from you. You know what a thief does? Well, everybody does. Some of us probably were thieves at some point in our life. I don't know nobody that picked up and moved something that didn't belong to him. Come on now. You know I'm telling you the truth. We all got a little thief in us. Of course, we've been born again now. You see, but that thief, a man's going to slip in. Paul teaches it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Watch this. He's speaking to the apostolic church. There are the times and seasons, brethren. You have no need that I write unto you. So somebody been teaching those folk about the end time. That's why the ministry needs to know and have understanding of the end time. The preacher warned not only the people, the church, but the world that Jesus is coming. Paul said, for yourself know perfectly that the congregation in this valley knows Bible prophecy. It's this folk right here at the Pentecostal Covenant. And I'm not yanking my own chain or patting my own self on the back. Amen, but I've taught you people for 40 years. You ought to know these things. Verse 3. For when they shall say peace and safety, and that's a message within itself, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, who are you talking to? You know. But ye, brethren, the church, the bride, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. That is. He's liking and he's coming to a thief in the night. not only darkness, but gross darkness. Ye are all the children of light and the children of day. We are not of night nor of darkness, he said. But my point is, he likens the coming of the Lord to a thief in the night. And the implication is that only those they, Brother Roger, that are looking for him. Is that not clear in Scripture? I just read that Hebrews 9:28. That only those that are looking for him. That's why it's important to be ready. Pray that. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Baptized in Jesus' name. Because when he comes, I preached last week, it's going to be in a moment, twinkling of an eye. If you're not ready, you won't have time to get ready. We are the children of light, Paul says. Not only did Paul refer to his coming as a thief, Revelation, the Bible says, chapter 16, verse 15, listen to what Jesus said himself. Behold, I come as a thief. Why as a thief? Because only those that are looking for him will he appear a second time without sin in the salvation. He said, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth. Shouldn't be great watching for the coming of the Lord. Man, it's going to be like them stepping out in front of a freight train when it happens. Bam! It's going to smack them right full in the face, and they'll never know what hit them until it's everlasting too late. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments when he live right, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. Jesus said, likened his own coming to a thief in the night. So did Paul. And not to make this a lengthy message, but so did Simon Peter refer to his coming as a thief. Paul did. John did. Jesus did. Peter did. The teaching is at his first coming at the rapture of the church, which is a pre-tribulation rapture. Amen. He wanted us to know, amen, that it's a secret coming. And only those that are looking for him will he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Now that, folks, is a biblical fact. Yeah, there's teachings out there that said, no, that's not the way it's going to happen. Then I would like for them to explain to me 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, Hebrews 9:28. I'd like them to explain to me Revelation 16:15, and right on down the line. Think about it. The stage is being set right now for this great day of rapture. Amen. And we need to know. And I'll probably maybe preach next week. I hope you're not getting tired of hearing these prophecy messages. Because we need to know these things. Amen. The problem with these other doctrines, the danger of the mid-trib doctrine and the post-trib doctrine, we need to have our eyes. How many times have I preached down through the years that the Bible says, watch as well as pray? Watch, the Bible says. Watch. Keep your eyes. The Bible says on the prize. Keep your eyes. Amen. Looking not necessarily literally to the clouds. Amen. But spiritually looking for the coming of the Lord Jesus. Because those that preach those other false doctrines are not preaching the coming of Jesus. Now they may say to the contrary that they are, but they're not. What they're preaching, we'll get more into it maybe next week. They're preaching the coming of the Antichrist. They're saying, in essence, that the Lord Jesus cannot come back until the Antichrist is revealed. When I read in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and then shall that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. You see, and Paul makes a direct reference to the rapture in verses 1 and 2, by our gathering together unto him. So we know that his coming in his first appearance, according to Paul, 1 Thessalonians 4, amen, that he's only coming in the clouds. We have established already the only people that will see him will be his bride that he's espoused to now. Them that love him more than anything else, those that are baptized in Jesus' name, those that believe in one God, and that Jesus is the manifestation of that one God, those that believe and live holy and dedicated lives before God, amen, and endure unto the end. Those are the people, amen, that will be raptured on that great day of rapture, and it'll be a secret coming, according to Jesus, according to Paul, according to Simon Peter, and according to John. That's the way it's going to happen. I cannot understand for the life of me how folks can read those scriptures and not see and have understanding, amen, of how this thing is going to happen. A two-fold coming is not that complex. It's controversial, but it's not that complex or complicated that we cannot understand it. If we were rightly divided, I told you in Bible study, in order to understand the Word of God, it must be examined and studied from Genesis to Revelation, and we must rightly divide the Word of truth. And what confuses some of these people, the Bible does make a distinct coming of the Lord in which the Lord Jesus will leave heaven and he will come all the way to earth, and everybody in the world is going to see him. That's why he's coming back twice. Let us go to Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7. Watch this. Now, I'm not going in as much depth in these messages as I have in Bible study, because there's just too much to it. There'd be so much ground to cover. I think my last eschatology studies, there was 47 studies. 47 of at least 1 hour long of Bible prophecy studies. There's no way that I can do any more messages. All I can do is hit the high parts and just show you that the Bible does teach that he's coming as a thief. That the Bible does teach only those that are looking for him shall he appear the second time. That the Bible teaches that he's coming once and making an appearance only in the clouds and never touches earth. But in order to understand correctly and interpret correctly, we must also understand that there is a second coming of the Lord, and at this coming, everybody is going to see him. Listen to what John said in Revelation. He said, "Behold, he cometh with clouds." And what those mid and post people do, they confuse because of the word clouds. Because there's clouds at both appearances. Well, it's kind of hard to get from heaven to earth and not go through clouds, no matter if you come a dozen times. Is that true? So that shouldn't confuse anybody. Sure. And they'll say this coming in Revelation 1 and 7 is the same coming as the revelation of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And that's what they claim. And that's what they preach. And that's what they teach. And it's incorrect. He said, "Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him." That's directly contrary to Hebrews 9:28. Hebrews 9:28 emphatically teaches us that only those that are looking for him will he appear, make an appearance, be seen. But they say it's the same coming. It is not. "Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him." And some are confused by that. I've talked to them about this as well. How can that be? See, because there was Roman soldiers that pierced his hands. Inside. Are they going to see him at the rapture? No. When he said, "Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him," he's making a direct reference to the nation of Israel. Israel was for having him crucified. They were, in the natural, responsible for his death. For they manipulated the Roman government into crucifying him. I preached it many times. They also would pierce him. And all kindreds, watch this, of the earth, that's everybody, shall wail because of him, even so, amen. I'm telling you, it don't take a Bible scholar to understand the difference in the coming of the Lord in first. Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, and this coming of the Lord in Revelation, when it says, he makes a clear distinction. One is secret, and the other is openly. Now watch this. Another biblical proof that there are two comings of the Lord. Now, the coming of the Lord for the rapture, he's coming by himself. Don't make me go back and read it to you. And Paul said, for the Lord himself. He could have said, for the Lord by myself. Shout amen. Man, I'm making this up. I preached it for 40 years and it's still good. For the Lord himself shall be. He ain't bringing nobody with him. Not so. In the coming of Revelation 27, now he's bringing armies with him in this coming. Now, watch this. What I teach has been a sound doctrine for 6,000 years. I'm teaching no foolishness, no silliness. I've studied what I teach. Man, it's been biblical doctrine for 6,000 years. You said, prove it, I'm going to. See, that wiped the sweat out of my eyes. Man, you all said, I'm cool. Oh, no, I do. Man, you took me literally when I said, don't let me. You won't even move your foot. I'm not ready to shout with you. Glory to God. But watch this. He's not coming alone in his second coming. Jude, chapter 1, verse 14, watch it. How many of us know who Enoch is? He's a seventh from Adam. Man, that goes back 6,000 years. I told you what I teach, buddy. It starts in Genesis. It runs through Malachi, opens back up in Matthew, and ends in Revelation. And you'll never understand the Word of God until you rightly divide the Word of truth and study it from Genesis, amen, to Revelation. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied. Just what old Brother Wolford's preaching. Makes me feel good. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh by himself. Wouldn't that sound like a direct comment? If there was only one coming, that'd be a direct contradiction. Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000, plural, of his saints. Who are them saints? The saints Brother Wolford preaching 6,000 years later is going to be raptured in a moment, a twinkling of an eye. Amen. That's who they are. Amen. Enoch knew about it. Amen. The prophets knew about it. Amen. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John knew about it. Amen. Jesus preached it. And it's the gospel truth. Amen. There's a twofold coming of the Lord. Amen. It's a pre-tribulation rapture. Any other teaching than that is absolutely emphatically false. And you need to know these things. And then it also the seventh man and prophesied of these saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. I'm telling you, folks, the stage is being set. The stage is absolutely being set. Hell is roaring. You know why? The Bible says, for the devil knoweth he hath but a short time. That's why there's so much hell on earth. That's why there's so much evil in the world. That's why there's so much drugs in the world and alcohol in the world and natural thievery and not safe to send your children out to schools and all of the evil, amen, that's out there in the world. Amen, because the devil knows he has but a short time. I'm telling you, if he's working fiercely, amen, he's working in a manner like he's never worked before. Amen, going about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And there's plenty out there that he's devouring, even as I'm speaking. He's coming back. I'm telling you, what you see in the world today is not going to prohibit or prevent prophecy. The Bible cannot be altered. Now, we pray and we ask God to intervene in our lives, and he does. But Bible prophecy cannot be altered or changed by no man. Paul said, the wind or angel from heaven can preach you in the gospel. Then they shall let him be accursed. It cannot be. It's set in stone. It's going to happen just like it's detailed in Scripture. The stage is being set for the mystery of iniquity doeth already now work. And the mystery of iniquity began to work in the garden when the serpent deceived and beguiled Eve. Absolutely. Now we know, we have shown you, that the Lord is absolutely making a secret appearance in the clouds for a specific reason that is referred to that coming as a thief in the night to rapture his church, his bride, that blood-bought church of Calvary, and the saints that's gone on by the way of the grave before us. He's coming back to collect those jewels, those precious saints that shone a light to you and me all of these years here at the Pentecostal Tabernacle. Man, there's a lot of folk that came to the Pentecostal Tabernacle that's going to be in heaven. Won't that be a reunion? Give the Lord a hand clap. Man, I tell you, won't that be glorious? Amen. To see all the saints, amen, that has passed on in the past 30 years that we've been here, to see them once again. I'm telling you, God knows how to comfort us. And Paul said, comfort one another with these words, you see. Death is not the end, but the beginning. But the last place I want to go in Scripture, as I told you, the number one difference between the two comings is one is coming secretly, the other he's coming openly. One is coming by himself, the other he's coming with armies. Revelation chapter 19, the big two places we get there. Now watch this. John said, and I saw heaven open, and behold a white horse. This coming of Revelation chapter 19, verse 11, is the second coming, when every eye shall see him, proven in Scripture. And I saw heaven open, and behold a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doeth judge and make war. Verse 12. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. That's Jesus. Watch this. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses. This coming, he's not coming alone. The armies of heaven. And he tells how they're dressed. Clothed in fine linen, white and clean. That's holiness. God's bride is a holy bride. She dresses right. She looks right. And I'm referring to the church as a she. Not just women, but men need to live holy as well as women. Come on now. Holiness is for his bride. And we all make up the bride of Jesus Christ, men and women both. And we ought to be clothed in fine linen, white and clean, which is holiness. And when we are raptured, when this corruptible puts on incorruption and this mortal puts on immortality, we'll be ushered back into heaven. And we'll be there for 7 years. The marriage supper of the Lamb takes place in heaven, not the millennium. That's where the saints will receive their rewards, you see. So we see here again the distinction between the two kingdoms. It only takes a little rightly dividing. And now I'll go, I guess, to my last place in Scripture. Zechariah. Okay, this doctrine I teach, it's old stuff. There's nothing new about this, though, Mike. Man, the prophets prophesied. Zechariah prophesied of it. Jude prophesied of it. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of it. Jesus spoke of it. Paul spoke of it. John spoke of it. And Ron's speaking of it. Right? Well, sure. Somebody's got to do it. Watch this. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, that and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle. And that's going to happen. And the city shall be taken. Now I've explained all of that in Bible prophecy. The houses rifled. Speaking of the Jewish houses. The women ravished, meaning raped. And half of the city shall go forth into captivity. That will be when the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet sits himself up in the temple of God as God, demanding to be worshipped as God. That's what Zechariah is prophesying of right there in verse 2. And half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. Verse 3. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations. That's the battle of Armageddon, Revelation 16:16. And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. It's a valley outside of Jerusalem called the Valley of Jehoshaphat and the Valley of Megiddo. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle. When he used to fight Israel's battles, he's going to fight them once again. Now, this is my point. His first coming, he's coming where? In the clouds. We'll meet him in the air. He never touches down on earth. The earthlings never see him. Now here, distinctively, and his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives. Mount Moriah. How did Zechariah know? Let me get my numbers right. I can't remember them very much. Probably 600 years on down into the future, there would be a baby born, the Messiah called Jesus. And he would live 33 and a half years, be crucified, laid in a tomb for 3 days and three nights, be resurrected, walk this earth for 40 days, appear unto about 500 witnesses. I won't preach one day. Is God real? Is there a God? Not only do I know it, but I want to take the same Bible that I'm preaching out of today and prove he's real. It can be done. I've done it before and I want to do it again. Is God real? For the devil, I've been driving down the road. And the devil hop up on my shoulder. He said, "Donnie, they ain't no God." I begin to scratch my head. You reckon they are? He said, "Well, preacher, you think thoughts like that? I sure do." Then I begin to look way out yonder. And they say God is billions and billions and billions and billions of miles away. And the devil said, "How can he know what you're thinking?" there's 7 billion people on this planet right now. What do I feel like? Boy, it's a lot easier to preach and not run in the way. I tell you that. I bring bed no sweat about it. My Bible says that the God that I serve, that was manifest in flesh in the person of Jesus Christ, knows the amount of hairs on every head of every 7 billion people of the population of this planet. That's how great my God is. Give him a hand and clap of praise. The devil said, how can God know all these things? We got to do a little more than just say, God, we got to prove it now. You got these agnostics and atheists. You know, I'm going to tell you something. That scripture, I'll have to go back to it. My mind's limited. God is not an atheist on the planet. They are not. They want you to believe they are. They want you to think they are. But I don't believe they're the God. Yes, you do. You know how I know you do? Because the same Bible that could not have possibly being wrote by human hand, by unction of his own self, Satan. That's why. That they were dealt when God created man and when the person was conceived in the womb wherein where that conception is. That's where life begins. God was dealt to that person, that soul. Amen. That faith. Amen. That there is a God. Amen. And he resides in it. You may not know a lot about him. You may not understand but very little about him. Amen. But put it down deep in you. You know there's a God because God placed it in you. You see, you can deny it. You can lie about it. And I'm telling you, amen, you know there's a God. And one of these days, I'm telling you, amen, the day that say those foolish remarks, amen, going to stand before that same God and give an account why they did bow their knee, amen, to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you something else, buddy. Amen, people's going to bow one day whether they admit to it or not. In God. Huh? I said, how do you know they ain't? I said, how do you know they are? Well, of course, I'm just not to start a question. If I can ask you, you can ask me. I'm going to tell you. I'm going to prove it to you that there is a God. Now, let's get back to the message. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives. How did he know 600 years ago when Jesus died and resurrected that he would lead those people about 500 out to the Mount of Olives? And while he was there, a cloud came down and received him upon his sight. Huh? And did not the angels have stood by and said, this same Jesus that you see go away shall come again in like manner? 600 years apart, approximately. How could Zechariah have written that and it came to pass 600 years later? Had not God told him what to write? Somebody said it's a lucky guess. When the Bible got it right, you're a fool. My Bible, that same Bible, amen, to give all men the breath of life, said thou fool, has said in his heart, there is no God. That's right. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst of great earthquakes coming, both toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley. And half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. Verse 5. And he's warning the nation of Israel. purpose of the great tribulation. And you shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach unto a seal. Yea, ye shall flee like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. And the Lord might watch it. And the Lord, my God, who's Jesus? You got that right. There's only but one God, and his name is Jesus. He is the Father, he's the Son, and he's the Holy Ghost. And the Lord, my God, Zechariah said, see, because the Son of God hasn't been born yet. And he certainly wasn't sitting on the right hand side of the Father neither. I ain't got time to go into all that. I can prove that there. And the Lord my God shall come and all the saints with me. See that coming, every eye as a single would come. Every eye shall see him. They will. So it is clear that there's going to be a rapture. It is sound biblical doctrine that the rapture takes place prior to the 7 years of great tribulation. Not that it went farther and deeper. Daniel had a 70th week prophecy. 69 of those weeks have already come to pass. But that 70th week of Daniel's prophecy is yet to be fulfilled. And that 70th week, which is 7 years long, is what Jesus makes a reference to in Matthew 24 and 21, I believe. For then shall be great tribulation. Jesus prophesied 600 years after Zechariah, just what he gave Zechariah to write. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. The coming of the Lord is near. I've said it. There was a time to praise now. Because once this event we call the rapture happens to be for Gentile people, you won't have a chance no more. God won't deal with you no more. He'll turn from you and turn back to the nation of Israel, his chosen elected people. And then their blindness will be lifted and they will realize they were the ones that pierced him and that Jesus was exactly who he said that he was. He was the Messiah. I'm glad that I know him today, ain't you? I'm glad that I accept him when he knocked on my heart. I said, yes, Lord. I'm glad I said yes, because this thing is truly about ready to wind up. And I believe this with all my heart, according to Scripture, the next thing prophetically, major, and globally to happen will be the rapture of the church. It won't be the revelation of the Antichrist. We, the church, will never know who he is by identity. We will not. It was not given to us to know. We only know him by titles. The little horn of Daniel, the son of perdition of Paul, the Antichrist by John, by mere titles. But he's out there. He's out there and he's waiting for the time clock of God to click the rapture, and then he steps in. If you're lost, we will give you invitation to pray. There will be time to pray. It's in his house. You know, I don't want to open this altar. If anyone wants to pray,